shallows. I was made to search the deep. If you're not in it, I don't want it. I want all of you, take all of me.
Blessed be your name. found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name.
Speak your name and I am healed. Sure. Good morning, SouthPoint family. Welcome to our service for February 21st. We have some great announcements this week. We are hosting an in-person church service on Sunday, March 7th at 10 a.m. at Salt Creek Community Park. We ask that you RSVP on the Church Center app so that we can be in compliance with the Chula Vista Parks Department. Please feel free to invite your friends or family. You can easily text them the details of the event through the app. We can't wait to see you again. Our bike drive for families in Rosarito, Mexico kicked off last week. From now until March 1st, donations or sponsorships of new or used adult and children's bikes would be most welcome. Please visit the app for all the details you need to participate. Thank you for your support. And lastly, as a church family, we've weathered a tough year by encouraging one another, praying for one another, and reaching out to each other. The church would love to support you in continuing to do this by sponsoring a coffee meetup with you and someone in the South Point community. All you need to do is register on the Church Center app under Events, and we'll send you a coffee gift card for you and a South Point friend. This concludes our announcements for the week. Have a great service.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church. So glad to have you with us for our service this morning. Let's open up with a word of prayer, and we will jump right into our study through 1 Peter. Pray with me. Lord, we thank you for this day today. And we thank you for an opportunity, again, to hear from your word. Lord, we pray that today you would speak to us through it. And Lord, we pray that you would continue to do the work that you are steadily at work in our lives doing. We know, God, that even when you save us and you adopt us into your family, that you continue to sanctify us and transform us and change us to become those people that you created us to be. And Lord, that's the people that we want to be. And Lord, we are also grateful that you are constantly growing our understanding of you and our faith in you. And today, as we look a little deeper into some aspects of our faith, we pray that you would help us grow in that way, that we would be people that are full of faith, people that see you and your hand at work. And because of that, Lord, that it would transform the way that we live life on earth. So, Lord, we give this time to you. I also, Lord, want to just pray this morning for each of those that are connected to our church family, Lord, that maybe need just an extra touch from you this morning. Maybe they need some encouragement today. Maybe they need a physical healing today. And Lord, I just pray that you would be near to us. Even as you teach us and you guide us, you're also there to comfort us and be near to us through each of the lives that we live. And so, Lord, I pray that you would be near to us as well in all those ways today, and that we would be encouraged and that we would continue to move forward in the ways that you have called us to. So be with us, Lord. Guide us today. We love you, and we thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and open up your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 1. And today we're going to look at verses 8 to 12. And we're going to begin this morning by reading those first two verses, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8 and 9. So go ahead and read that with me. Here's what it says. Though you have not seen him, referring to Jesus, though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. So that's where we're going to start here today. And we're going to talk about just these two verses and how this causes Christians to be seen by other people. Peter is going to put his finger right on it. Now, there are a lot of negative perspectives about Christians from those who are non-believers. And I think that all of us have experienced different degrees of that. For some of you, you were raised in Christian homes, and you had always heard the Christian perspective and had that Christian way of seeing the world. For others of you, it was the exact opposite of that. Maybe you hadn't heard anything about Christ or the gospel or understood the Christian point of view. And your first exposure to Christianity might have been in college or at work or who knows where. And there's all these different perspectives from those who have experienced Christianity in different ways. But especially for non-believers, when they look at Christians, there's a lot of different perspectives and ways that they imagine a Christian thinks about the world. Here's just a few of those perspectives. For some, they think that Christians are traditionalists, that they are people that really don't think for themselves. They just kind of hold on to some antiquated belief, a belief system that was their grandma's. And they just sort of keep things the way they always were. They just say, well, my tradition and my family is that we're Christians. We go to church on Sundays. We dress this way. We say these things. We don't say those things. And that's part of being a Christian. And it's just this tradition that has been passed on generation to generation. And so some non-believers say, oh, they're just Christians because that's how they were raised. All right. Secondly, sometimes people view Christians as these religious mystics, that they are people just trying to get in touch with spiritual forces in the world. Very similar to the Jedi in the Star Wars movies. You're just looking for the force. And that's what Christians are all about. And really, they would say it's no different than any other world religion. Everybody's trying to get in touch with the spiritual side. Okay, sometimes that non-believers would view Christians as simply idealists or optimists, saying that Christians have really just invented a faith so that they can escape the cold, hard realities of life. They say, well, you just really want the world to be good and you want there to be something after this life that's better. And so you just kind of created this faith, hoping that something's better than it really is. Sometimes they just view Christians as absolute crazies, just crazy fanatics, no different than a Buffalo Bills fan that jumps off the roof of a pickup truck to smash a folding table, that kind of stuff. You're just crazy and you're all about the team and you're all about Christianity and you're just wacko. And then there's also the perspective of non-believers that say, really? I kind of feel bad for Christians because they're just sort of deceived, small-minded people. They've been fooled into trusting these fairy tales, really, so that church leadership can manipulate them and steal their money, like a cult. Right? Now, all of these sorts of perspectives are common for people that are non-believers, from people outside the Christian faith, especially those, in many cases, that either were raised in a Christian background, and maybe they've rejected that because they saw some of these things, or for even those that have really barely been exposed to Christianity and the Christian faith, and they're trying to make sense of it, and this is the sort of things that they come up with to explain what a Christian is. Now, part of the reason that there are so many of these different ideas is because there are some things about the Christian faith that are very difficult for non-believers to make sense of. And that's true. Peter here brings up some of those very things right here. Here's a couple of them that we're going to see here, right here in verse 8 and 9. And the first one of those things is this. He says it right in the beginning of verse 8. He says, though you have not seen him, you love him. One of the reasons that it's hard for non-Christians to understand Christianity is because Christians, as Christians, we love a person we have never seen. We love a person we've never seen. Just like the churches that Peter was writing to originally, we have not seen Jesus with our own physical eyes. At least I never have. Now, that doesn't mean that there's no way that Jesus was a historical person. In fact, there's astounding evidence all through the historical record that Jesus of Nazareth was a real person who lived when and where the Bible says that he did. Even non-Christian historians agree with that. You'll find many non-Christians, non-believing archaeologists and historians that would say, absolutely, there was a real Jesus Christ who walked the land of Israel back then. That's not a problem. But the step from just acknowledging the existence of a historical person and moving all the way to loving that person is a huge step. So one of the first things that Peter says here is, hey, you don't see him, but you still love him. And that's true. Secondly, he goes on there and he says, though you do not now see him, you believe in him. So not only do we love this person we've never seen, but we believe in a person that we do not currently see. We believe that Jesus rose from the grave. We believe that he's alive, alive today. And we believe that he is going to bring us into an eternity, a perfect eternity with him. Are those radical thoughts? Yes. Can you see why people from outside the faith would be like, whoa, that's a major thought. You're telling me you believe in some person from 2,000 years ago. You love this person. And not only that, you believe that this person 2,000 years ago raised from the dead and now has made promises to you that when you die, there's going to be a heaven and eternity waiting for you. Now, you've got to confront those things and look at those things because that is exactly what we believe as Christians. And that's very hard to get our minds around. Now, why is that so hard? Well, we're going to get there. We're going to answer some of those questions and look at that. So we love a person we've never seen. We believe in a person that we do not currently see. And on top of that, another reason that we're baffling to non-Christians is that he says there at the end, he says, and you rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory. On top of that, not only do you have this belief system, but you're filled with this inexpressible, glorious joy. It's unexplainable. It's unspeakable. We can't really describe why it is that we have this hope and why we have this joy in our lives as we go through life. And so that confuses people. And to them, to those who are outside the faith, it goes really against common sense, especially if you have been raised in a culture of empiricism. Okay, now empiricism is a $5 word from philosophy. Empiricism simply means that all knowledge is based on sense experience. That's all empiricism means. It means that the only way that we get knowledge is through our senses, through the things that we can see, the things that we can taste or touch or smell or hear or feel. That's it. That's the only way we can get knowledge. And in our culture, oftentimes, that is a great way of acquiring knowledge. You test it. You study it. You look at it. You feel it. You lift it. You taste whatever it requires. That is a good way to learn knowledge. However, it's not the only way. Now, in fact, in our culture, one of the phrases that you've probably heard, you've heard it said, that seeing is believing, right? I'll believe it when I see it. That's how I know something's real. That's how I know it really happened. That's how I know it's true. Seeing is believing. Now, that does work to a certain degree, but is there anything that we believe in that we can't see with our eyes? How about wind? Can you see wind? No. Now, you can sense wind with some of your other senses. You can hear the wind at times. You can feel the wind blowing on you at times, but do you see it with your eyes? No. So seeing is not always believing. We believe that there's wind. You can see the devastation of a wind after a hurricane tearing down trees, but can you see it with your eyes? No, you can only see the after effects of the wind that's come through. All right, well, there's something that kind of breaks that seeing is the only way to believe idea. But what about things that are even less apparent than the wind? What about gravity? Do we believe in gravity? Do we believe that it is a force that in this world, on this planet, that gravity is real? Well, yeah, we do. We live our lives based on gravity all the time. But can you see gravity? No. Can you taste it? Can you smell it? Can you hear it? Can you feel it? No, but you can see the results of what gravity does as a force, as a law of nature in this world. All right, let's even go a little more broad there. What about love? Do we believe that love is real? Can we have knowledge of love? Last week was Valentine's Day. And you might find that lots of people were celebrating love and they believe that there's a real love, but you can't empirically, you can't understand love in that way. And it's very similar here when we start talking about our faith in God, that we may not see the physical human body of Jesus, but we do see the evidence of Jesus in our lives and in the world. And those are some of the things that cause us to have hope and to have a belief in him. In fact, earlier in 1 Peter, back in chapter 3, we saw that he said specifically, we've been born again to a living hope. Why do we have that hope? Because we have seen an evidence of God working in our lives. And it causes us then to overflow with that inexpressible joy. The Bible has a great example of this. In John chapter 20, after Jesus raised from the dead, it tells us there in John 20 that he appeared to the disciples. Now, it wasn't all 12 of the disciples, because at this point, Judas was already gone. So there was 11 of them, but even 11, not all 11 were there. In fact, it tells us that one of the disciples, Thomas, happened to not be with the rest of the disciples when Jesus appeared. And Jesus appeared to the disciples, and he talked with them. He spent some time with them. And their minds were blown. Jesus left. Thomas then came into the rest of the room with all of his other close friends, these other 10 guys that he had spent the past 3 years with. He trusted them. He believed them. They were his best friends. And they all tell him, Thomas, you're never going to believe this, but Jesus was here. And he's like, yeah, you're right. I'm not going to believe this. Because unless I see the marks in his hands and I put my hand in his side that was pierced by the Roman spear, unless I experience all that, unless I see that with my own eyes, I will never believe you guys. You're all nuts. Well, 8 days later, they're all gathered again together, and Thomas is with them. But this time, Jesus appears again. And this time, Jesus comes over to Thomas specifically and says, hey, Thomas, here's my hands. Here's my side. Take a look. I want you to see. I want you to believe. And what does Thomas respond at that point? My Lord and my God. Now, Jesus says something very important to him there in John 20, 29. Here's what he says. It says, Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? But listen to what Jesus says. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. Jesus makes that statement for Thomas, but it's also a statement for us. What Jesus is laying out for those who would follow him thousands of years later, like we are, without ever seeing him in the flesh, he's letting us know, look, there's a real blessing here because you can have eyes of faith, as we're going to talk about as we go on here. You can have eyes of faith and you can believe because of the evidences around, rather than even being able to see him physically in that way. And that's what Peter is going to tell us here today. That's what he says. Let's read those verses again. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. You have heard that seeing is believing, but Peter says that believing is seeing. Believing is seeing. try to understand this with me a little bit. We can imagine a world that is redeemed, a place where God is on the throne, where sin is eradicated, where there is no sickness, no pain, no aging and decay and death. We can imagine that because we believe. We can see those things with our eyes of faith because we believe. We can envision our own salvation because we believe. We can see the work of God's hand in our lives and in the lives of others and in creation itself because we believe. We believe, and then it allows us to see. Our belief helps us see beyond the current circumstances. And that's what Peter's talking about here. That's what he's reminding these churches of. He says, look, you love this person you've never seen because you have a belief. And because through that belief, you have seen evidences of what God has done and is doing in this world around. And that's why our faith is so precious and so precious to us and so valuable to us. What God is doing in the world is mystifying, even to his own people in many cases. We can see little bits of what God's doing, but there's a lot of things we do not understand. We cannot figure it out. People of faith, however, have always functioned this way, believing even when they don't see. And that's what he's saying here. Go on and read with me verse 10 now. And here's what he says. Concerning this salvation, the salvation he was just talking about, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to be yours searched and inquired carefully, inquiring what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the subsequent glories. It was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves, but you, in the things that have now been announced to you through those who preach the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. Now, what's he talking about here? So he says, look, you've got this belief, and I realize that you don't always see things in the physical realm. But this belief allows you to see things that are beyond you. And now he uses an example of the prophets, the people of God that came years, hundreds of years before Jesus, who saw what things might be like, and they heard what God was saying to them in regards to Jesus. They saw it and they believed it, even though they never saw it, even in their lifetimes. That's what he's referring to here, these prophets, specifically those who had been sent by God before Jesus came to earth to tell the people that God was going to send a Messiah who would suffer in order to save them from the brokenness of the world and establish an everlasting kingdom. You realize these prophets, you go through the Old Testament, and we have a whole section of what's called major prophets in the Old Testament and minor prophets. Prophets like Jeremiah and Isaiah and Ezekiel and Daniel and Micah and all a whole list of them, right? And they never saw Jesus either. None of these prophets. They never saw him with their physical eyes, but they did believe that he would come and do all that God told them that he was going to do. Now it says here, the prophets, they searched and inquired. Well, what did they search and inquire from? The scriptures that they had, which at the time, especially for some of those prophets way back when, there weren't a whole lot of scriptures yet. The entire New Testament had not been written. Most of the other books of the Bible, many of the books of the Bible hadn't been written when some of these prophets lived. All right, so it wasn't just that, but especially they were seeking the voice of God. They were asking God to speak to them clearly about what was happening. Prophets are those who speak for God. That's the simple definition of a prophet. As we, back when we studied in the book of Hosea, You can go back into our podcast and listen to that if you're interested in it. But that was an Old Testament prophet that we looked at. And I had my dad come, Dr. Dan Spross, and came and gave us a message about prophets specifically and talked a little bit about that. And one of the things that he taught us in that is that prophets, primarily, they would do what we would call forthtelling, not foretelling, okay? What's the difference? Forthtelling means we're telling you the way it is. God has told me to tell you this is the way things are right now. And that's what the prophets would often do. They'd come and say, look, you've sinned, you've done this wrong, you've done that wrong, or you've done this right and that right, and therefore God says this about it. And he makes a statement. But then there's also times, less, but there are times, and this is where we confuse it a lot of times, is that sometimes prophets would also do what would be called foretelling, meaning into the future, prophesying about what would come and what would happen. But for the most part, the job of the prophet was simply to tell the people what God was saying for right now. And there was a big weight in that because if they were a true prophet, they had no margin for error, none at all. In fact, if they spoke their own opinion and claimed it was the voice of God, they were supposed to be killed. And actually, we have many examples of that in the Old Testament where God specifically says, I didn't send that prophet. I didn't tell them to say that. And he would actually tell them that to be able to speak that to the people. And that's what we're seeing here. I want you to notice in verse 11, this is interesting. It says that when they were inquiring what person or time, the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and subsequent glories. The prophets, these prophets, had the Spirit of Christ in them before he'd even been born. Now, I want you to understand that because it's a little bit of a chronological head trip for you because you're like, wait a minute, the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of Jesus was in these Old Testament prophets, but Jesus hadn't even been born yet. Yeah, because remember, the Holy Spirit is God and is eternal, just like the Father and Son. A perfect example of this knowledge and understanding of the Holy Spirit speaking things to prophets that would come would be found in Isaiah 53. We don't have time to read it today, but if you get an opportunity this week, maybe go back and read Isaiah 53, which was written probably 600, 700 years before Jesus was born. And as you read through Isaiah 53, start looking for all the things that you recognize about what happened in Jesus' life. The prophet Isaiah heard a word from God, spoke it to the people, and didn't even understand all that he was saying. All he knew was, God gave me this message, I'm supposed to speak it out. I don't know how it's all going to come about and what's going to happen here, but this is the way it is. And you'll see parts of Jesus' life being described in detail 600 years before Jesus ever came onto the scene. So these prophets were people who believed God, but then who God gave the ability to see beyond themselves and declare his message to the people even when they didn't understand what they spoke. So what about now? What's he talking about here? How does this all fit in? We have the privilege of living on the other side of the cross, right? These prophets of faith never could see or hear all of what Jesus was going to do in the world. Even as Isaiah prophesied that in Isaiah 53 about what the Messiah would suffer, he couldn't understand how that was all going to play out. And they would never experience the Holy Spirit coming into the world and watching the gospel begin to spread into every nation and culture like we have. They did hear the voice of God. The Holy Spirit spoke to them. But they didn't see that poured out on everyone. They didn't have those privileges, but they knew that the messages that they carried from God were important. And he tells us here, they knew that they were important for the generations that would come after them. And they served as guideposts for others, just like John the Baptist, the last of the Old Testament prophets, would do as he came preparing the way for Jesus. Prophets believed God and then began to see what he would do. Now, I felt like as I was preparing for this message, I felt like I wanted to do a little, kind of a little sidebar on prophets and prophecy. We're going to jump back here into 1 Peter in a minute, but I want to take a second to step over to the side and talk a little bit about this because I think it does matter in the world that we live in right now. Because there are people today who claim prophet status who aren't prophets at all. And it's important for us to be able to discern the difference, okay? And this is nothing new. Like I told you, in the Old Testament, there was times where God specifically said, I didn't send that person who claims to be a prophet. I'm not putting those words in that person's mouth. False prophets have always been around and they will always be around. But it's important for us as Christians, as believers, to not get caught up in the confusion that comes with some of the false prophecy that is out there. For one thing, you should notice that prophets are humble servants of God. And unfortunately, a lot of times the prophets that we hear about now are anything but humble servants. They tend to be more the superstar celebrity type of a person. That's what they're trying to do, throw out this big persona and have these entourages and all of this. False prophets are usually chasing the sensational and the supernatural and connecting it to some sort of money-making enterprise. So these false prophets are building these empires of wealth and storing all this up, all claiming it's because I have the insight into God, so the special voice from God. And what happens is people get burned by these, as you can imagine. You'll have a prophet that comes to do this special speaking engagement and tells this person, hey, if you would just empty your bank account right now and give me all that money, God is telling me he's going to triple your finances. And by that little offering that you give, it's going to be multiplied into something you can't even imagine. And they'll go through this whole thing and people fall prey to it and they get really knocked off balance. And it's a very sad thing. Now, so there's a danger in that and getting caught up into false prophets, but there's also a danger to believe that God has stopped speaking or that God would never use prophets or prophecy again. As if the technology of prophecy became obsolete. But the privilege of hearing the voice of God, we know, was expanded to all believers when the Holy Spirit came. We also learn that the Holy Spirit specifically equips believers in different ways. That's what Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 to 11. Here's what he says. And remember, this is the New Testament. This is after Jesus has died and rose again and ascended. This is after the Holy Spirit has come into the earth at Pentecost. He's speaking to a church in Corinth. And here's what he writes. He says, to each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the ability to distinguish between spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. And listen, all these are empowered by one and the same Spirit who apportions to each one individually as he wills. Now, it is true, the role of the Old Testament prophet whose job it was to prophesy about the coming Messiah is obsolete. There aren't Old Testament prophets anymore talking about the Messiah that will be coming. Why? Because the Messiah already came. Jesus already came. But we still need to hear the voice of God. And as the people of God, we should want to hear the voice of God. But the problem is, for many of us, we don't always take time to stop and learn to listen to the voice of God. And even if we are people that regularly are trying to tune our ears to hear God and spend time in prayer and understand God's voice and time in the Word, even then, there's other times that God bypasses that and speaks to us through other people. I mean, guys, that's what we're doing here this morning. I'm not here just to teach you the Bible. That's not the purpose of what we're doing here. I can teach you a whole lot of information about the Bible. But what our goal is to understand the Bible, to study the Bible, yes, but also be transformed by the living Word of God. To hear what this book that God has set up for us, and hear what it says to us and allow it to transform our lives. This isn't just an education class on the details found in the Bible. My hope for these messages would be that there would be the prophetic word of God going out into our lives. There is still a need for prophecy in the church. The problem is, we've just, in many cases, feel like it's just this weird, freakish thing that happens, and so we get scared of it. But look what he says, actually, Paul says later in 1 Corinthians to that very same church in 1 Corinthians 14. Listen to this. It might blow your mind if you've not thought about this before. Here's what he says. He says, pursue love and earnestly desire the spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy. For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God. For no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit. On the other hand, the one who prophesies speaks to people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation. The one who speaks in a tongue builds up himself, but the one who prophesies builds up the church. Now, I want you all to speak in tongues, but even more to prophesy. Wow. What's he saying here? And what do we get from this? What we know is we need men and women in our church who are willing to listen to God on behalf of our church and then speak those things to each other. And I do understand that some of you are hearing this morning and you hear the term prophecy and it kind of freaks you out because you're like, oh, I've heard some crazy things spoken in the name of prophecy and I want to get as far away from that as I can. I understand that. There are some excesses and there are some things that have gone really off the deep end with that. But we can't throw it all away. Prophecy should actually be a normal part of life for a Christian community. In the Old Testament, King David, who's a very well-known king in the Bible, King David actually had a prophet, kind of a staff prophet, as on the king's entourage. And David's primary prophet in most of that time was a man named Nathan. And one time, after David had been established as a king and he had built himself a palace there in Jerusalem, he called Nathan, his buddy and the prophet, in, and he said to the prophet Nathan, he said, hey, Nathan, you know, I've got this house built, but I really want to build a house for God. I think it'd be incredible if we had this fortress, this temple, this amazing place where people would recognize, wow, God lives in their midst, and that's his house, something tangible. Doesn't that seem cool, Nathan? And Nathan, being a prophet of God, thinks, that sounds like a great idea. And so he says to David, yeah, do it. Go for it. Do whatever's in your heart. Sounds good to me, David. Well, later that night, as Nathan goes on about his business, he hears a word from the Lord, a specific word of prophecy. And it's not what Nathan expected. In fact, God says, Nathan, go back in. You got to talk to David. Nathan heads back in, and God speaks through Nathan and says, actually, David, I'm flattered that you would want to build me a house. That's great and all, but I'm doing just fine. I don't really need a big temple. And on top of that, you're a man of warfare and bloodshed. And if somebody's going to build me a temple, it really shouldn't be you. And so ultimately, we know that David receives that as the word from the Lord and abandons his plan. He's the king, but he's listening to a prophet. Now, it's a normal conversation that's taking place there. It's not anything weird and strange and mystical. It's simply the Lord speaking through a prophet to someone else. And And as the story goes on in 2 Samuel 7, what ultimately happens is David just gathers all the supplies and passes it on to his son Solomon, who would then build the first temple. All right, so this is just some of what I want you to think about as you think about prophecy. Now, as we start wrapping up here in 1 Peter, let's come back to 1 Peter. And I also want to look at this one phrase at the very end there of verse 12. Because it says, you know, the prophets, they realized by their eyes of belief, they realized that they were setting things up for us in the future. And it was all surrounding the good news that the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. And he says there at the very end, things into which angels long to look. Things that angels want to look into. Here's something that is a cool image here in 1 Peter that I want you to get as we look through this section. The redemption of the world. God's plan being unfolded in history is the main event, even in heaven. Sometimes I think we get almost numb to the gospel message and the things that we hear. I mean, even as we started off today and I told you, look, some non-believers look at Christians and they're like, wait a minute, you what? You believe in a guy who died and rose again? You love that person and you believe that that person is somehow going to turn all this world around and fix all the brokenness and start into heaven? And for us, when we're not confronted with it on a regular basis, we're like, well, yeah, that's the way it is. That's the way that we believe it and we see it. And we can almost become numb to the fact that that's an amazing thing. All of those things are amazing things. Resurrection from the dead is an incredible event. The possibility that we can be made sinless and perfect and live for eternity, that's incredible. And it's not just incredible for us as humans. All of the spiritual realm, even angels themselves, these beings that were created by God from the foundation of earth so far back, thousands and thousands of years ago, these angels are captivated by what's going on in this plan that God is unfolding. They're fascinated by that plan. Sending Jesus was kind of the ultimate season finale that was going on. And the angels are like, oh my gosh, the Son is going into earth as a human. He's going to be born as a baby. You got to be kidding me. And then as those 3 years play out in ministry and they see the different things that Jesus is doing in the earth, and then ultimately he's taken to the cross, the angels are sitting up there thinking, no, Father, you can't let that happen to Jesus. Like, he's getting closer. They're beating him up right now. They're walking him up there with a big old chunk of cross on his shoulders. This can't happen. And then it does. And their minds are blown. And then he resurrects. And then they're like, whoa, I didn't see that one coming. This is amazing. Then the arrival of the Holy Spirit, that's like the mega launch of the next season. It's like, what's going to happen next? Holy Spirit is now going to come in and flood the earth. Whoa. And then Christ's return will be the incredible, stupendous, glorious conclusion of the fallen world and the beginning of this boundless eternity of bliss. This is an amazing thing. And we want to make sure that we have the eyes of faith to see how incredible this is. We should be just as astounded as the angels are when they're just longing to look at this and to understand this and get this. This should be the way that we feel about the gospel in our own hearts and our own lives. Why? Because part of it is, once we recognize what God's at work doing, it fills us with that joy. It fills us with that comfort. It fills us with that hope. Not only that, that sort of understanding of the gospel message is what motivates us to even share the gospel message with others. This is incredible news for people to be able to hear and to understand. And our belief in him allows us to see what he is unfolding. So, as we finish here today, do you see this reality? Can you see it? Can you imagine it? Can you look with eyes of faith? And how does that then cause you to want to move? He set up these first 12 verses. He set us up for action, and that's what we're going to see next week. He's going to start talking about, now what do you do with this? What sort of action are you going to have? But can you see that? What do you see when you look with spiritual eyes at our community around us right now? We naturally always look from a seeing is believing physical standpoint first. The disciples were no different. But as followers of Jesus, he's called us to something else. And there's one more passage I want us to look at here before we finish, because this is exactly the sort of spiritual sight that Jesus had and that Jesus calls us to. He was with the disciples at a time back in John chapter 4, and they had been doing a lot of ministry and things like that, and they were hungry, and they were trying to figure out their physical needs of, okay, where are we going to get lunch and all this, and how are we going to sort this out? We're traveling to the next town. And they have this very interesting conversation with Jesus. And here's what it says in John 4, 31 to 38. It says, meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, Jesus, saying, Rabbi, eat. But he said to them, I have food to eat that you do not know about. So the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him something to eat? And Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. Do you not say there are yet 4 months? Then comes the harvest. Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. Already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that the sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true. One sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored and you have entered into their labor. Look, it would be easy for us to look around at our community right now, or look around at the world, look around at our nation, and think that things are hopeless. I know, especially for those of you who are older and have spent a lot of years on this planet, you look right now at the state of things and you're like, oh man, we are headed for a collision. Things are falling apart everywhere I look. But when we begin to lift our eyes, as he says here to the disciples, lift your eyes. Is he really meaning your physical eyes? Just look up a little higher? No, he's not talking about physical food. He's not talking about physical eyes. He's talking about spiritual eyes, eyes of belief. When we lift our eyes believing in who Jesus is and what he's currently doing, then we begin to even see our purpose in the world. That's what he says. He says, look, if you lift up your eyes, you're going to see that there are fields ripe for harvest. And I'm sending you into the world to bring in that harvest. He's sending us into the world. And believing allows us to have hope, not just for the future, but for today as well. For today as well, we can have hope for our own transformation. We can have hope for those who are lost. We can have hope for the healing of those who are sick. And we can rejoice even in the hardest moments of life because we know that grace and salvation has been poured into our lives. Look, guys, Peter points it out here, and it's true. As Christians, we really do see things differently in this life. And it's because of our belief. Non-believers aren't always going to understand this. And that's okay. Because as we believe in him, we're going to be able to get to see him do the glorious work that he's doing in the world. Let's pray together. Father, my prayer for us this morning is that we would truly become people with eyes of faith. And that through our belief, Lord, that we'd be able to see what you're doing. And God, I pray that you would speak to us as a church. I pray that you would speak to us as individuals, and that you would also teach us to be able to speak those things to one another. We need to hear from each other, and we need to hear from you. And you often use us to speak to one another. And Lord, I pray that we are a church that is full of hearing your word, and a church that is always following your guidance and your direction. Even if it's at times where things don't seem to make sense to us, as long as we're faithfully following you, Lord, you can do the impossible. You can do the things that are far beyond what we can understand. And Lord, I pray that we become those people, people that hear your voice, people that are full of faith, full of belief. And Lord, that we would take that and enter into the work that you have for us in this world. Lord, I pray that our church would be a church full of people that are hope-filled. And it's not because we just have this optimistic viewpoint on life, but it's because we know you and we've seen you and we understand the evidences of you throughout our life. And Lord, that we could bring that knowledge of you and that understanding of you to the people around us. There are so many people in our communities, in our schools, in our neighborhoods, at work, that do not know you. And I pray, God, that you would use us to bring those people to faith, that we'd be able to show your light, your evidence in our own lives to them, that they would come to know you and believe in you as well. Bless our church, we pray, God. I pray again for just an encouragement and a strengthening to everyone who's part of this church community, that you'd be near to us, that you would bring us back together safely, quickly, and Lord, that you would fill us with a sustaining hope and joy every day of our lives. We love you, Lord, even though we do not see you, and we thank you for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week ahead, and I hope that you get to spend some time now in worshiping the Lord through some music.
Hi, everyone. It's Martin Smith here. Greetings to you all at SouthPoint Church. And I'm just so honored to be able to lead you in worship today. So let's keep singing, God is good.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining me. This song says just a really simple, brilliant statement. It says, we are here for you. So wherever you are, join with me. Let's do what we do best. Let's sing.
We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. Let our praise be our welcome. Let our songs be a sign. We are here for you. Yeah, yeah. We are here for you. Let your breath come from heaven. Fill our hearts with your life. We are here for you. We are here. We are here for you.
To you our hearts are open.
To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. Alone are holy, only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. Yeah, let our shout be your anthem. Your renown fills the skies. We are here for you.
Let your word move in power.
Let your word move in power. what's dead come to life. We are here for you. We are here for you. To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. Let your fire fall down. Let your fire. Let your fire fall down. Yeah. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in place. Let every heart adore, let every soul awake. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. Be welcome in this place. Oh, be welcome in this place. Be welcome in this place. Oh, be welcome in my heart, Lord. Be welcome in my heart, Lord. Be welcome in my soul.
Come on, let's sing. We welcome.
We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. Yeah. Let your fire fall down. Let your fire fall down. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
My hope is built.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the He is Lord, Lord of all.
darkness seems to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Yeah, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak and made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne.
Christ alone, come on.
Christ alone. Cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Christ alone,
Christ alone. You're my Lord of all. Jesus, you're my Lord of all. Majesty. Jesus found me just as I am, empty-handed, but I love in your hands. We're singing majesty, majesty. Forever I am changed by your love. Of your majesty, majesty, we're singing majesty, majesty, your grace,
by your love, in the presence of your majesty, majesty. Majesty, Jesus, oh, our Majesty.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below, and praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. Praise God from